Executive Director and Chief Curator here at the Nerman Museum at JCCC, and I'm delighted to see you all here. Very excited because Lauren Quinn's family is here from Los Angeles, so thank you for being here. It's really nice to see that support for your daughter and her first solo museum exhibition. So, without further ado, drawing from a pool of the unformed and the entropic, Lauren Quinn renders shapes caught in a process of emergence or recession. Parts grow out of other parts, and like bacteria, material starts to infect and invade. Her mark making implies a passage between or network among dimensions that generate sensuality and movement. They reveal a nimble boundary between fetish and foul, blood and marrow, purity and perversion. Lauren Quinn was born in Los Angeles and raised in Atlanta, Georgia, and now lives between Los Angeles and San Francisco. She earned her BFA from the School of the Art Institute of Chicago in 2015, attended Skowhegan School of Painting and Sculpture, and received her MFA from Yale School of Art in 2019. Her work is in some pretty impressive public and notable private collections, including the ICA Miami, the High Museum of Art, Fine Arts Museum of San Francisco, Phoenix Art Museum, the Perez Art Museum in Miami, the Walker Art Center in Minneapolis, the X Museum in Beijing, and some private collections like the Arnault Collection. I always say that, and leave it at that. The Arnault Collection, say no more. This evening, she will be in dialogue with Juliana Halpert. Juliana is an artist and writer currently based in Los Angeles. She earned her BA from Vassar College in 2012 and her MFA from the Art Center College of Design in Pasadena in 2020. Her writing is published in Art Forum, Aperture, Book Forum, Extra Online, Freeze, Art in America, Contact Sheet, and many others. Juliana is also the author of the essay, Lauren Quinn, My Hellmouth, which you can find on the Nerman Museum's website. And it was because of this brilliant essay that she wrote that so perfectly framed Lauren's work that we invited her here tonight to be in dialogue with Lauren Quinn. So please join me in welcoming Lauren Quinn and Juliana Halpert.
Thank you, JoAnne. That was incredibly generous, and I can't express how excited I am to be here and to get to sit in front of one of Lauren's extraordinary paintings and to pepper her with questions. So thank you all so much for joining us. It's great to see so many people here. So thinking about where to start, I think maybe the best place would be to talk about the title, My Hellmouth. Okay. What does it mean, and where did it come from?
This is the first time on the mic.
Yes.
warming up again for this. So my Hellmouth is building off of a couple other shows and ideas that have been snowballing into this. My Hellmouth is, firstly, it's connected to sound and to my voice and to tone and to the mouth, which is also a tunnel, and this sort of cyclical thinking through symbols in which I start to just dive deeper and deeper into that logic. I've been thinking about this idea of bottoming out inside of the logic. I also have been really interested in building out that logic by finding inversions to things, and I felt that the shape of the Hellmouth is this like natural and massively sublime inversion. And so I was sort of posing it like that and untying it from a lot of other connections, and really that's why it's my Hellmouth. but I guess to start off, I have recently been calling my Hellmouth this version of a cantilever, and the last painting in this show is called My Cantilever, which is that one. That's the last one I made. I think of it as a counterweight and a way of continuing to balance myself out in the process.
And what is this one in particular a counterweight to?
Well, it's a counterweight to the one to the right, to Decking Eye. They're actually kind of inversions of each other, because they're using the same drawing and not drawing, they're using the same print and the same structure, but on opposing sides, and it starts to build a symmetry, both of form, but of printing and of mark making, and it's also of color. I think that they kind of contrast each other in a way that I find interesting. And Decking Eye is the piece of hardware that you use to tie a boat down. So if I think of one of them as being solid ground and the other as being the most leading question I have, it would be between these two paintings. But also, I mean, this show is hung in a fairly symmetrical way. This painting, Cold Trailing, is my Hellmouth is on the other side, and I start to think of my Hellmouth as the entrance and Cold Trailing as the way out. So we'll start with titles.
No, yeah, sorry, I let off with titles. Well, maybe we can start from the beginning of the process. And in terms of planning a painting when all you have is empty canvas, what's the first step for you and in forming an idea for one of your works? Where does it begin?
I like to start with something that I really have a problem with, something that I feel is very objectionable to me and to my sensibilities. So I'll start with a shape, but the worse the better, kind of, you know, because then I have no problem moving forward. I have to fix it immediately. So I like to have the problems come first. But to explain how they're made is to say that you can see every layer at once, and that's sort of how the marks operate. What I do is I'll start with a color and a shape or a drawing and a pattern, and then I cover that completely in another sort of another painting, basically, and then while that paint is wet, I carve away, and I carve into the paint, and you sort of can see, like the first layer, the shape, the musculature, the bone structure, and you can see the wet paint on top, and then you can see the printing, which is maybe the third step out, which is it's litho ink that is. It's a mono printing technique. It's called trace monotype, is how I learned it. And I've been really just building out what it means to be using it. But it's an impression. So I either draw on the back and then I push onto I push on that drawing and it creates, how do I explain it? I flip it on its back. I draw on the back, and then underneath is a layer of ink, and where the pressure hits is where it prints. And I'm interested in the ways that I can't control it.
And this is something you've essentially invented yourself. I mean, the trace monotype method is a printmaking method.
No, it's a printmaking.
It's not really something that's being applied to painting very commonly, is it?
I think that I'm really interested in the ways, in the elements of failure and control inside of it, and in building out my own ways to use it. But it would be wrong to say that it's something because Miro used this technique a lot. It is like I think it's fundamentally sort of a surrealist technique. What you're doing is you're drawing, and you get the inversion of the drawing, and you get the impression of what you did, but you can't necessarily see what you're making. And so I think it has a lot of ties to the subconscious and this sort of Freud's mystic writing pad lineage there that I don't want to not acknowledge. And it's very relevant, I think, to me, and very useful, but it's also in the practice. It's all about repeating a symbol until it travels into something else, something much wider, and sort of following this logic, as I'm saying, but following this trail.
I want to go back to something you said at the beginning, which was you like to start off with one of the worst drawings or one of the worst shapes. What makes a shape better or worse?
Well, sometimes I'll just hide a body in there, or like a pelvis, or something that you know is not allowed. But I also think that what makes it objectionable depends on what it is. There's this painting here. It's called a Laundrette truism, and it was made over two paintings, and the brother of this painting is I made it much earlier, but it started with a cross section of a head, like a head being cut in half. It's like the anatomical illustration, and I thought it would be nice to hide a face in plain sight, because there's so many instances of pareidolia when you're looking at abstract paintings, where you see a face, you know, you see something, but it's always something. But what was also nice about making this one is that I was sort of playing off of the two. So I would set them either kissing, sort of these two faces, they would be kissing each other, or they'd be the other way, and they would sort of spread out like a pelvis. I keep saying pelvis, and I think it's because that holds weight for me. This painting, you know, you really lose the connection to it, but if I were to tell you all the secrets, it would be that it started with a picture of two angels facing each other. This one is a little bit different, but it's all there.
I just remembered that the first time I ever visited your studio, you showed me a book of anatomical drawings that you had. Was that what it was? But it was this very fascinating book. But I mean, there seems to be a wide range of interests that you have in terms of figures and shapes. I see angels, bats, which interestingly seem to have a similar kind of formation with the wings, but with faces and pelvises. Is that the plural? Is it pelvi? It's pelvises. Okay.
I like pelvi.
Pelvi.
Pelvi is
good. hands, you've mentioned. What is your interest? Yeah. What's your interest in anatomy, which I think is different from just the body, too? I think it's anatomy, maybe, that interests you?
Well, I'm interested in I've been calling a lot of these marks tubes, and then there was a point in which I was thinking about nerves, and to me, a tube is also an artery, is a system of tunnels, which is also, you know, the underground, and I use these symbols that we're referencing, and I'd like for them to play out in the way that they also function in the paintings, which is to say that there are systems of nerves involved with this painting, but they act like a system of nerves. Or the reason that I was connected to this shape of a bat is because in one instance of how I'm drawing it, I feel that a bat is shaped like an arrow, which has always been interesting to me, but I also was connected to the bat because, how to describe this, because I thought that I have a vivid memory of this in Atlanta growing up, There was a pool in my backyard and bats would skim the surface and they would pick up bugs. And I was thinking about this mark and what the action felt like, and I was remembering picking up the paint and the scooping of the skimming of the bats. And so it was kind of equating those two. But I think it's, you know, it's, I think that it's, that's for me to generate meaning, and it generates the paintings, and I think that the paintings can have and hold charge because there's no movement for the sake of movement. There's always, there's a quality that I'm reaching for and reaching around, even if it's in the dark, kind of looking for the through line.
Absolutely, and I think that all of that is what makes your work, I mean, so unique, but also somewhat different than just pure abstraction. Of course, we have a lot of abstraction here, but we know that there's so much just sort of packed into it that can still sort of comfortably fit in the figurative with the abstract marks. And it just, it begins to float in some other realm that somehow can encompass both, which is one of my favorite things about your work. Also, so wild to see you touch the paintings. I forget that only Lauren can touch her paintings. I was like, what are you doing? But I think she's touched them a lot. I'd love to talk about the symbols too, because there is a symbol in the other room too, right? And in the title as well.
Yeah.
So what is this symbol shape and what does it mean to you?
So it's a few things at once, but I lifted it out of a picture of a symbol, and I should say C-Y-B-A-L, but I'm interested in the flexibility and the flexibility into symbol, basically. As I'm referring to these symbols with an S. It's also a shape that, it's a shape that when you look at it dead on, it could be like a vortex, or it could be a needle, you know, like dead on. And I was really into that. I really like that it sort of holds the quality of light that the volumetric marks, but it also breaks that down in a different form. And I should talk about the tubes.
Yes, let's talk about the tubes.
Because we were talking about abstraction, and this mark came from looking at a Léger painting, Fernand Léger painting, and it's classic cubist French painter. He called it tubism, which I think is really cute.
I didn't know that.
But it's a way of organizing motion and kind of everything has almost equal weight in a sense. And I was looking for an organizing factor in my work when I found this mark, and I don't use it like he uses it, but I think I think it's important to say that when I say a tube, I mean these larger swaths of marks. I mean it's kind of everything, but I also mean an artery.
They're so bodily, but they're also so kind of the current world in this like metallic, beautiful way. And I was surprised that when I heard you first mention Fernand Léger, to look at his work, and I don't really associate cubism with color or shimmering spectrums, but he had such an interesting similar spectrum. And I guess I'm curious, are you making these marks with a single wide gesture with a paintbrush? I know that's a very technical sort of
question. No, it's fine. They're all like a fairly small, uniform, like, very fundamental. It's called a Phillips head. No, it's not. That's something else. No, it is. It's called okay. Phillips. Anyways, very simple, uniform brush, and sometimes it's half a brush, sometimes it's the full brush, sometimes I'm using my whole body inside of it. At certain points, I like to put the paint on the brush with a lot of medium and let the paint move around. And that's what creates pattern. And what pattern does is it creates a sort of unanimous color and motion, like a school of fish. There's something sort of iridescent about it because it all has equal amount of volume and value systems are sort of located. It creates, the color stays kind of pure because of that, not pure, but it stays bold. It's, the color is located. And what it does from then on is when I'm carving away, you see the pattern underneath and it creates this rippling line. And when that line is sort of wiggling with a certain type of value created by these, the paint systems, it pulls it forward. And so it falls as far forward as printing on top or, you know, something that sort of cuts away at the density of the thicker tubes.
It really does feel like everything is sort of fighting towards the surface, and yet they feel so deep and infinite as well. But I was thinking about the shimmering of the tubes, and it does feel like if they were just flat color or dark, then they would just fall back or something. But I do want to ask you about color, because this is something I don't know very much about also. But how do you plan your color schemes? How do you create such complex interactions and make them work? Do you have a set sort of spectrum of colors you want to work with for a painting at the outset? Or are you choosing as you go? Or how does color planning work for you, basically?
Well, to talk about maybe like these two paintings here, think of my cantilever to be working on inverting the painting to the right, decking eye. But I'm, you know, I put this painting in the gallery before I finished the show, and I was able to see how it acted in the space. And I realized how much heat was sort of emanating from the reds, and these vermilion kind of washes really picked up and carried through. And I thought that it was appropriate for my Hellmouth to be warm. And so I really started to bring out that heat. I think that color sensibility is something that is built over larger than one show, but I'm interested in kind of breaking it down as much as possible. I also think that there's an element that I want to mention, because you're talking about metallic, and I think of these not as metallic, but I think that there's something about the working wet into wet with these sort of the competitive areas of mark making, that the dirty parts sharpen the sharp parts and vice versa. And so I think it really plays off of breaking things down, plays off of this like types of additive, subtractive questions.
Could you just briefly explain what wet into wet means for those non-painters in the room, including me?
Wet into wet is working in an additive way with wet paint. So sometimes these paintings feel athletic because there's a window of time in which I have to work on them before they dry. And especially in LA in the summertime, because the paint evaporates. It's, you know, when I finally work up the nerve to do something, I have to cancel my plans. But I think wet into wet is something that I want to be sort of knee deep in problem solving in these paintings most of the time. And I feel that it's hard to hold on to form while you're working wet into wet. It's hard to hold on to color and keep it vibrant.
How much of the process overall are you planning out beforehand, and how much of it is something that you have to figure out and work through as you're going? And how much is just pure improvisation?
I don't think there's pure improvisation. I think it's really built step by step, as in painting by painting, I'm honing how to make these paintings. the question that's always asked is, how do you know when something is finished? And that is the sensibility you build through knowing your process. But can you repeat your question?
Yeah, no, I'm sorry. And I'm sorry to use the word improvisation, like it's just you're sort of
improvisation is the same as saying something automatic. And we were talking about printing and these like automatic drawing and like surrealism are very tied.
Yeah, I see. I guess how much changes in the middle of making a painting?
I think that I always start with like a lot of hopes for the painting of what it could be, but I think I'm always having to work against that impulse. Like the impulse to preserve is always going to stop you from making a choice that could move you forward. So the right paintings and all of the paintings, honestly, are a huge problem for me until they're finished. And it's normally about halfway through that I abandon whatever plan I had. And then I have to start over. And that's where the real work is. Because it's all of these areas of process get me to the point where I have to think about what this painting specifically would need.
That sounds rather hard. What was I going to say? I'm just really struck by that because, I mean, I was actually speaking to your father before this, and he was talking about how he thinks that there is a connection between your process and writing. And writing to me is the most torturous process in the world, but when it pays off, it really does. So I'm just really amazed by your ability to work through to recognize problems as a good thing and to work through them. But sort of moving on from there, I'd love to hear you talk about, I mean, there is such perfect symmetry in the show, but I want to hear from you what it's like to work on a square canvas as opposed to a rectangular canvas and how that changes things and what kind of different problems arise from each.
Well, squares have a natural balance, and to relate this to maybe the conversation we're having about problem solving, to if everything you do is going to throw the balance, you kind of you sort of have to deal with that center point, that vanishing point, the center of the painting. You have to deal with it first, and it makes it harder and it makes it more fun. maybe not more fun. I really enjoy painting, and I really enjoy problems of painting. But they have this, they have this balance that I have to always be working around. It's always presenting a problem. Whereas I tend towards width, and I know when something is finished when I feel like I could keep going past the edges. But also, as I'm working, I start to get really close to the surface, and I feel like I lose some peripheral vision, especially in this one, I think.
And by losing peripheral vision, you mean you just sort of get swallowed into it?
Yeah.
And you're working really closely
mm-hmm.
in it? Okay.
I get very absorbed.
Because in the beginning, it's more like you're doing the broad strokes with the larger tubes, and then as you get closer to the surface, are you getting more intricate, or the marks get more intricate as you get further along in the process? Or is it the same throughout?
There's no perfect system. I would say that there's pattern that acts underneath, and then normally in the end I pull it out again. I tend to use those marks again. I'll sort of, as the system that I explained, I'll just start to do it again or invert it. The real conclusion is when there's the fourth thing. There's something else that's always involved, but it's just never something I can predict. Yeah.
I'm excited to mention the forthcoming catalog that will be published in conjunction with this show. And in that book, the really incredible writer Sarah Lehrer-Graiwer interviews Lauren about her practice, and I was lucky enough to get to peek at it. But in that interview, you did mention that during the pandemic, you really felt you didn't enjoy seeing your work or work in general on just on the screen. We were all limited to just viewing art on the internet and via our devices. How did that affect you, and did it affect your work in any way?
Yeah, it definitely affected my work. I think that the shutdown was a real pressure cooker moment for me, and I think it broke open the work and I found something new. I was doing all of these different things that are a part of the work in sort of located zones inside of the paintings. I was carving, I was printing, and I was kind of doing these larger blocks of paint. But I felt that there was a lot that was lost. I felt that the conversation lended itself towards screens. And I just felt like all of the surface tension that I'm really excited about was gone. And so I basically took the painting as it was and decided, what if I had zoomed in? So the carving became wider and the mark became wider. It changed the paintings. It changed the space of the paintings, and I had to kind of confront that. And it was definitely a breakthrough that I have a lot of questions about that I need to work through.
I have to say, there is such a difference to me to see the work in person. I've been looking at it on screens, and just to finally come in here today and see it and see that there is actually quite a lot of texture and paint on the surface, it's really incredible. I wanted to ask also about your most recent gallery exhibition, actually most recent in the United States, at Blum & Poe, where you showed concurrently with the very legendary sort of feminist artist, bad-behaving feminist artist, Linda Benglis. What was it like to have your work in conversation with hers?
I felt that I was making gifts to my idea of her work, and there was one of the biggest paintings I had ever made, and it was dedicated and named after her work and her. I feel that at this point in time, it sort of goes without saying that I am a feminist artist. Like, I am a woman making these paintings. At any particular time, I'm interested in the tone of the paintings and what tone they represent by who I am making them. And I liked kind of calling back to someone who's moved the needle. But really, I'm also interested in tone as in sound. And I had another show called Vocal Fry, which I was interested in literally the frying out of one's voice and how that relates to the frying out of the ink and how it relates to the sort of moiré patterns that are induced by like an image being compressed. But it's also sort of a moiré pattern to me is it looks like iridescence, and iridescence is sort of this a quality that's based on motion, a quality of color and of light. And I think about those color systems when I'm trying to build out these colors. So I think it's all sort of, it's all in the pool that I get to bring with me.
I mean, so much looks like sound or energy to me too. I mean, you're talking about both sound and heat. How much of it is about these kind of particles or movement in our world that we can't necessarily see or articulate? I guess that wasn't really a question, but
that's absolutely a question. I think that. I feel like I've been connected to several symbols that are sort of a radius around me, and what I'm doing is I'm trying to understand why they are all relevant to me. And sometimes they act like idioms in that they can hold so much and also speak very plainly. When I say a bat or a hand, these are very, or an egg or something, it's like a very simple form, but to me I'm interested in the way that, like, in a two-dimensional sense, a spider and the drawing of a hole, or a spider and a sun, are equivalent to me, and I'm sort of like flying through these associations. So all of this is to say, I think I, in order to talk about the elements, the abstract concepts that I am interested in pursuing and sort of digging out, I end up using a different sense, you know, language of sound to describe something visual, because it's like I'm reaching around to find the meat there.
Definitely. I mean, I feel like I learned so much about your inner world by looking at your work. And it feels like it's so much sort of about the interiors of bodies, but maybe the interior of, I don't know, like a sound speaker or somebody else's body or it's like it's both sort of electricity and sound and body at the same time, but there is some sort of commonality there, which might be energy or...
Yeah, I mean, they're also neurotic as I am, you know? somebody told me I was like wound tight recently. They told me I was a bow that was outstretched. And I was really in love with the description because I felt that it was accurate towards how I like construct my life around this work and how it how it does show a side of me and a tone or an attitude that I'm sort of projecting. What happened?
Bow and arrow. I mean, an outstretched bow, that sounds like a symbol or something that would make it into the bone structure of your work a little bit.
I think she was describing the tension.
Right.
But yeah, I mean, I think that these paintings have started to take longer and longer to make, and also I've become more productive at the same time, and they've become even more dense, and that's that kind of pulling in that I was talking about, is that they become even more dense as I'm also, I feel like they have developed. And to bring it back to my Hellmouth is to say that I'm interested in how I could possibly be bottoming out inside of this, and haven't gotten there yet. But also these titles, they're always, as much as they are a conclusion, they're gesturing forward, and I'm always calling back to them. Yeah.
I think my last question, based on that answer, is what did you learn from working on these paintings and this show? And where is this show going to take your work in the future?
So actually, there's two paintings that one of them is in the other room, and it's called Symbol Stitching, and the other one is this one here, Laundrette Truism, and I felt that I kept trying to make this shape of something circling down a drain, pretty much, and so you see the sort of descending mark from tallest to smaller, kind of spiraling, and I was looking for that same quality, but I found a different way to do it in symbol stitching by like sectioning the tube instead of repeating it and curling it. I feel that all of these paintings start to rhyme with each other, and I start to understand them better. What did I learn?
No, that counts. That definitely, I mean, I know the part, and I encourage everyone to go look at it, but symbol stitching, the painting over here, there is like sort of the left section of the canvas. It feels like you've kind of even started this new gesture within this way that you have, I mean, all of your different processes, it's like, it's all there and it's still your kind of gesture, but something new is starting over on that side of the canvas too.
Yeah, I think I've been interested in like an exuberant, excessive tone and what angle that takes on as me, and who I am in making that, kind of in making something that is by something massive that is made up of all of these hairy details, it sort of becomes this beast, you know, to bring this metaphor along. And I think that in the way that I have been diving deeper into this like cantilever, this sort of like massive, sublime idea, I've also been learning so much more about poise and about withholding again. And I couldn't tell you where it's going yet, but I'm working on it and I feel so excited by this show.
Well, I'm excited to see where it takes you. I think it's time to open it up to a Q&A if anybody has questions. And
Lauren, I was just going to ask, what's your time frame between paintings? Do you go right into another painting, or do you?
I'm normally like halfway through a painting by the time the other one's finished. I work on a big batch at once because I think that when I start to like something too much is when it becomes dangerous, and then I have to take whatever feeling I have and put it somewhere else. Or if it's sort of like I'll play with my impulses over several paintings. So I was talking about how this was made over two paintings. And what I was sort of doing is I took the same shape and repeated it. And then I got to play favorites. And one of them was like the ugly duckling. And then the other one was the one that I was kept working to try and preserve. And so what it did is, I was making them the day after to see if I could even repeat myself. They're very different paintings. But what I do is I play off of like I need to have everything in the mix to finish them. And I end up doing it. And I really miss this work. So I'm sort of restarting again.
I'll ask a question, Lauren. Oh, I'm gonna ask one first. So can you tell me the difference between seeing your work in the studio in process and then seeing it in a completely new space? I think lighting, things like that.
Well, thank you so much, because you did a great job with the lighting. You know, you could make these paintings in the dark and your eyes would adjust with the amount of time that I spend looking at them. I think that I knew that the light would be like impeccable here, and it cleans things up in a way that's so beautiful to see, but also there's no more perfect place to see it than in the studio, because that's how I finished it, and that's sort of the best possible outcome. So that's how it was intended, yeah.
My question is in regard to the fact that obviously the paintings are very intimate. The process seems very intimate. You have a story, and you remember so clearly about, you know, every mark that you made. And I just can't help but wonder, what does it feel like when you sell one of the works and it gets boxed up and sent across the country? Are you sad, or
yeah,
do you miss the work? Like,
I
it's
do.
Your child and it's gone and you don't know its new life.
Yeah, I think, yes, no, I miss paintings. I take them along with me into the next painting. And if I miss a painting so badly, I'll try and make it again. I think that that's actually one of these impulses that I have that isn't very helpful, because I'm trying to push it forward, but I'll try, you know. I always try. I think that I save paintings for myself, but I also I'm sort of a haptic worker, and whatever is in front of me starts to become a tool. So both. Both and.
Okay, thank you.
For this painting here, you mentioned that you started off with a couple angels back to back. Are these angels that you you drew, or were they something that you found that inspired you?
I found it, and it was like angels inscribing these long scrolls, and I couldn't do it justice because it was more of an artifact than it was a something. There wasn't an artist that was listed, so I'm like not crediting it correctly. Yes, there was a source image. It's very detached from that now, but I would be happy to share it, and I have, and I think that I was drawn to elements of framing. I was drawn to this, to the composition and the ways that I felt that the two figures were, they were facing each other and they were slightly offset from each other. And there was this symmetry that was implied but then broken and like in a very natural way. And it was a very, it had something a little bit wonky. Somebody, Kitty Wampus, I think it sat in the studio as this tiny shard of paper and collected more and more dirt and like paint until suddenly I found it again. And I think that I sort of have this radius of both drawings and scraps that are so important to me, and yet they're sort of, they're ephemeral.
I have a couple other questions.
Yeah, go for it. Let's go.
I'm curious about your journey into the fine art world and what it's been like in predominantly historically male-dominated field. Do you think that's changed?
I mean, I think that there's been women in the art world this entire time. I think that the painters and the paintings that I see, especially abstract paintings that I see, as I've started to learn more and more over the past 10, 15 years, I seem to be drawn to like other women artists as well. Like there's something about, without knowing who Jutta Kotter was, I was really drawn to the work, and I sort of, this German name that I couldn't tell if it was man or woman. But sometimes I'm very relieved to know that. Not that it's necessarily such a binary thing for me, it's just I think that I see the angle in the world in other work. I think sometimes knowing an artist, you start to see it like it's their fraternal twin or something. Like you see an element of them inside of it, inside of what you're reading. And then what was the rest of your question? You asked about like my trajectory into the art world.
It's going great.
I'm really, really thrilled about this show. I guess like I went to school. I went to many art schools, and I kept trying, and I tried to do other things, but I couldn't, because it was just like it naturally happened. I was always trying to paint, but I think the shutdown of COVID shutdowns happened right after I got out of grad school, and I think that was the type of pressure that it gave me. I was really grateful to have my studio in place, so I just sort of hunkered down and worked through it in a way, and I thought that was really an element of the trajectory that I couldn't have predicted, but really helped me somehow.
Thanks.
What is your journey to this process been like? Was there a lot of experimentation involved, and was that always on a canvas like this? Do you do small, do you do like mark making experiments on other substrates, or what does that look like?
I mean, I'll kind of work on whatever I have to work on. But so much of even the ink the way that I'm carving and moving paint around and working wet into wet, so much of it is about embracing anything that is a problem, you know, embracing any types of failure in the work and moving those forward and letting them show me something about the work that I hadn't seen yet, sort of like widening it. I'm not sure I'm answering your question, but they're not made with a plan of how they're going to end up. So again, it's sort of about honing the problem solving over long periods of time, over years.
Have you always worked fairly large like this? And is that kind of your favorite? Do you think that's always going to be your favorite?
It is one of my favorites. I've always worked around 6 feet, and I think I've always felt like a tall person or something. And I've always felt a little bit like I wanted to be inside of them or be able to reach all sides. I wanted it to be my wingspan, and then they naturally spread out. They got bigger, and they also got more detailed at the same time, which is crazy. But they did. They got more dense, and they also got much bigger. And I think that it's been really exciting. It feels, I've said it, but it feels indulgent to make something so big. It doesn't feel like work. It feels like, how could I possibly expect to like put this out in the world? You know, it's like so indulgent to me, and it's so much fun. Yeah.
Do we have one more?
I was drawn to the fact that you brought up surrealism and the automatic writing and your inversion of symbols. And I was wondering if you, because you're so non-representational, if there would ever be a moment where you would consider going with icons, or do you think about that? And do you think about bringing in more representational within?
I love that you used the word icons. I mean, like iconography as in?
I'm just like so basic as maybe like emojis or like any kind of branding language where you can twist that language back and forth on each other.
I don't feel attached to maybe the instances of iconography that you're using. Or that you're describing, but I like that. I am interested. I think that like angels is an iconography. Angels is a type of symbol that is connected to, you know, religious. Oh, it's not quite that. It's not that I feel that it's hidden. It's just embedded. I don't hide any of the, I couldn't hide my sources if I tried, you know, like, yeah, I think that it's many symbols, it's many different types of symbols laid on top of each other to create something that is in its own, something different, but I think that I just don't want to be a purist and say that it comes out of thin air, like, it doesn't, but sometimes, like, I think some of the things you're referencing, I mean, I pull from the shape of some ad or like the shape of a font or something is like speaking to me, and I think that I'm questioning what drew me to any instance of that and looking for the through lines of why I'm drawn to those things. So I think a lot about like synchronicities of why I might be interested in a certain symbol. But again, I think that the symbols are sort of they're not very loaded, you know? A hand is not very loaded. I think of it more as like a vehicle into the logic that I'm building out through making.
And that's a perfect place to stop. Thank you so much, Lauren and Juliana.